Hachette Audio presents The Proof in the Pudding, a Prudence Bulstrode mystery, written by Rosemary Shrager and read by Rachel Atkins.
Chapter 1.
Well, Mrs. Bulstrode, there you have it, just like you left them. 100 of your finest figgy puddings all in a row.
110, thought Prudence, as she perambulated up and down the shelves in the walk-in larder. A good cook always knew to make 10% more than she'd actually need. Well, you could always count on there being a waiter who'd trip over his own shoelaces, or somebody else who'd accidentally drop one on the kitchen floor, just so he'd have something to sneak home after shift. In a lifetime of working in kitchens, Prudence had seen it all. She'd rarely seen a walk-in larder as palatial as this one, though. This was the sort of larder that suggested there might be a new world hidden at its end. She'd worked in grand kitchens smaller than this larder, which felt, she reflected now, more like a wine cellar, with different crannies for spices and condiments, an alcove dedicated to baking ingredients, a shelf full of glass jars where various starters bubbled and frothed, and corners where strings of onions, parsnips and game birds were hanging. Prudence loved larders like these. There was a sense of exploration that came with poring over their shelves. Her figgy puddings, no matter how many of them there were the least remarkable thing of the lot.
How are they looking, Mrs. Bulstrode?
Each figgy pudding was wrapped in muslin cloth, tied off with Prudence's signature crimson ribbon. They'd been maturing here for 6 weeks, ever since that Halloween weekend when Prudence had first driven her camper van up to the tiny Yorkshire village of Scrafton Busk and entered these hallowed kitchens. She prodded one with a finger now, then lifted it to test its weight, and, peeling back the muslin just a whisper, drew in its heady aroma of nutmeg, cinnamon, and sultanas. The scent of the rum was enough to get a woman sozzled, thought Prudence, and that was precisely as it should have been.
Oh, Prudence smiled with some satisfaction. I think they'll do.
There was a twinkle in her eye as she turned around. In the larder doors, the steadfast figure of Francesca Thomas was standing as statuesque as a soldier. Francesca the Fantastic, they called her on the events management circuit. In Prudence's heyday, events management hadn't been nearly as grand as it was nowadays. There'd been a time when anyone with a healthy dose of common sense and commitment could organise an event. Now, you had to hire a professional. Francesca was willowy and blonde, but had the focus, precision and attitude of a Roman legate leading his legion to conquer an untamed land. She had a clipboard and everything. Have the rest of my ingredients arrived? Francesca checked her wristwatch, and Prudence heard her counting the seconds from 1 to 10 beneath her breath. Then, on her waist, a little pager started buzzing.
That'll be them now, Mrs. Bulstrode. But your kitchen assistant is attending, so perhaps we ought to take a tour of the dining hall.
Kitchen assistant, thought Prudence. Well, that was what she was. But she also happened to be Prudence's granddaughter. There was a time when the thought of Suki taking charge of a delivery would have frightened Prudence to her very soul. The words wayward, errant, short-sighted, and contrary had been invented for girls like Suki. But she'd aided and abetted Prudence on 5 jobs now, and with each one she was growing a little more skilled. Yes, Prudence thought, Suki could easily handle a delivery. Lead on, she said to Francesca, and marched out of the larder, leaving the figgy puddings behind. A barrel load of turnips cascaded over Suki's head. Ouch, she cried, hopping from foot to foot. Ow!
Ouch! Get this... Ouch!
Suki's actual words were much more fragrant than these. The word that exploded out of her mouth when the last turnip, a brute of a vegetable, surely fit to be used as the weapon in a very bloody murder, cracked her on the side of the head was so fragrant it sent one of Scrafton Grange's front-of-house staff scuttling away in horror. Evidently, they didn't have the very worst kinds of swear words in the remote Yorkshire dales.
"I'm sorry, miss," said the lorry driver,
standing on the platform at the back of his vehicle. He'd been angling one of the pallets on the elevator platform when the barrel slipped free.
"I normally deliver furniture, you see. It's difficult to spill a four-poster bed or a garden bench. We're not trained in turnips and winter greens."
Scratching his head and finding some not inconsiderable flakes of dandruff, which he proceeded to flick away, he looked back at the crammed interior of his lorry and said,
"What you doing? Battening down for winter? There's enough food in here to feed an army."
"The whole village," Suki replied, rubbing the bump on her head where the turnip had tried to end her short life.
"What?"
"I said the whole village. We're cooking for them all."
"The whole village? What, expecting to be cut off, are you? I'll tell you, I've had a devil getting this lorry up those snaking roads. A bit more snowfall and I'll have to spend the winter here myself."
It was here that the lorry driver, as dashingly handsome as a naked mole rat, decided to chance his arm.
"Hey, you could keep me warm with some turnip soup."
"Ice cold," Suki said. "No, thank you. Just help me get this lot into the Grange, would you? Time's ticking on."
The Grange. It sat in the heart of Scrafton Busk, like an imposing castle, which, in a sense, it was. Constructed 500 years ago, at the behest of some minor pretender to the throne, whose family had decimated itself in the Wars of the Roses. A big barney designed to prove whether Lancashire or Yorkshire was best. It even retained the turrets of its former fortifications. It had, the history book said, Suki's friend Numbers had been only too eager to do the research, been a singularly useless castle, positioned badly, protecting a dale which few people knew about and over which even fewer cared. It had been more vanity project than impregnable fortress. In all its days, it had seen not one siege. No armies had met in glorious battle on the pastures of Scrafton Busk. No king had lost his head in its courtyard, and no runaway princess been taken into its tower for protection. Just as well, then, that the National Trust had turned the Grange into one of the most glorious visitor attractions in the whole of the county. A building that had proven pointless as a seat of power was, hundreds of years later, very much in demand as an arena for concerts, festivals, one or two party political conferences, and tonight a feast, the like of which Scrafton Busk had never known.
"Here," said the lorry driver. "I've got 5 sacks of King Edward's, 10 tubs of marmalade, I didn't know the stuff comes in tubs, and a case of malt whiskey. Eh, you don't think I could have a bottle, do you? A tip for all this hard graft."
Suki barely listened. She was gazing out over the snowy pastures of Scrafton Busk. In front of the Grange, the village green was an expanse of pristine white. At its heart stood the snowman the village children had made. Somebody had evidently offloaded an unwanted scarf, because the poor creature was wearing a knitted monstrosity of the most lurid pink, and arrayed around the green's edges were all the picture postcard houses and shops of the village, every one of them strung up in twinkling Christmas lights. By the time evening came around, Scrafton Busk would be lit up in glorious reds, greens and blues. There'd be wassailing on the green, no doubt, and sleigh bells jangling in anticipation of Christmas. Suki's eyes did not deceive her. A red-breasted robin had landed on the snowman's top hat, and there he stood, trilling a merry tune. Was ever a sight as perfect as this, she thought. It might as well have been taken directly from a chocolate box. She didn't suppose anything terrible ever happened in a place as picture-perfect as Scrafton Busk.
Somebody was calling her name. She turned around, just in time to get slapped in the face by a crate of ice scallops as the driver lifted it from the lorry and saw her grandmother hallowing her from the doors of the Grange.
"Just bring it all through," said Suki. "If we're not in the kitchens and prepping in an hour, the evening's already lost."
"I'll have burger and fries," the lorry driver said, cackling. "I say, burger and fries for me," he repeated.
But Suki was already gone.
Prudence was waiting for her at the doors to the Grange.
"I want to show you something," she began. And soon Suki was following her into the heart of the building. "This place used to be the Great Hall," said Prudence at last. They had come to the doors of the Grange's most palatial room, a hall 10 times as big as the village hall back home in Chelwood Gill. It was a quarter the size of a football field. Ostentatious chandeliers hung from the rafters. Christmas lights and wreaths garlanded every window in every wall. And, across its length and breadth, grand oak tables were currently being expertly laid by the Grange's silver service staff. Suki was quite taken aback. She'd been on various assignments with her grandmother, but nothing quite like this.
"Well, Suki dear,"
Prudence said with a smile. The twinkle in her eyes told Suki that her grandmother was relishing the challenge.
"Do you think you're ready for this? 100 villagers, all invited to the midwinter feast. Every man, woman and child from Scrafton Busk will be here under this roof tonight. They'll be eating our muffin-topped winter stew, our winter root crumble for the vegetarians, of course, our lamb shank hotpot and Scarborough woof, squidgy chocolate pears."
"Your figgy pudding, Grandma?"
"My figgy pudding indeed, Suki. This isn't going to be easy. It's you and me against 100 ravenous stomachs. They've been waiting all year for this, and our bosses are counting on us to give them exactly what they need. You know what's at stake?"
Actually, Suki wasn't quite sure. The Forward Reach Energy Corporation, who was sponsoring the event, seemed to have some vague idea about winning over the villagers by romancing their stomachs. Suki didn't quite know what for, and right now she didn't care to ask. All that she cared about was that the clock was ticking. The lorry driver was still out there cracking jokes to himself while he spilled and bruised all their prize ingredients, and she was still, despite her grandmother's best efforts, a novice with her knife skills.
"To the kitchen, Suki," Prudence declared with a flourishing smile. "We've got quite a battle ahead."
Though no pitched battles between lords and kings had ever been fought in the hills of Scrafton Busk, a war was surely being waged in the kitchens of the old castle today. Prudence had been granted several of the Grange's kitchen staff to work as underlings. Surely a prerequisite when you were tasked with feeding an entire village, but somehow it didn't seem to make things any easier. Having an army in your employ simply transformed the job, so that Prudence found herself imitating a military general as she directed them in the assembly of an infinite number of individual winter stews, each to be topped with the muffin mix Suki was making. Lighter than a traditional dumpling, it had just the right level of refinement for an event like this. What's more, it was easy. Some of the girls, thankfully not Suki, who, in one of the few ways she took after her grandmother, had better sense, kept chirruping on about how this whole endeavour was like one of those ghastly mass-catering challenges on the newfangled television cookery shows.
"We should have cooked up a big cauldron of chilli,"
one of the girls shrieked, to gales of quite unwarranted laughter.
"Spag bol,"
crowed another, and Prudence shuddered. She had never been able to hear this abbreviation without a quiver of outrage running through her body. Still, the girls were adept at doing what they were told, and, in a twist of events Prudence had not seen coming,
Suki turned out to have an expertise in translating Prudence's more specific instructions to the chattering assistants. There was mess aplenty, but by mid-afternoon, when darkness was beginning to creep over the dales, and the first Christmas lights were lighting up the houses that bordered the village green, Prudence was growing ever more confident that tonight's feast would be a success. Content for a moment to step outside of the chaos and gather her thoughts while she worked through a spot of washing up, she stood with a nice cup of chamomile in the kitchen window and gazed out at the green. She'd been to some idyllic places in this country. Her old career had seen her whisked off to some of the most idyllic locations in the world as well, cooking for a competition winner on one of the Maldives' most sun-kissed beaches sprang to mind. But Prudence wasn't sure if the sight from any other kitchen window had ever given her this kind of satisfaction. The snow had gently started falling again, dancing in beautiful patterns over the snowman in the middle of the green. She'd stood in this exact spot every morning since she arrived in Scrafton Busk, fortifying herself with tea and crumpets for the day ahead, and in those dreamy moments had remembered being a girl herself, building a snowman outside the greengrocer's her father used to run, or with the other girls at St. Marianne's, prepping for snowball fights on the hockey pitch. Winter had a way of making you wistful, Prudence reflected, but what a joy it was to get lost in dreams of childhood again. She was still enjoying this moment when there came an almighty crash behind her and the kitchen assistant started turning in circles like panicked pigeons. Prudence turned around. Around 30 ramekin dishes filled with their tender braised chuck had crashed from the kitchen countertop to the tiled floor. An avalanche of beautifully cooked beef, carrot and heady luscious gravy.
Should have just done spag. Oh,
one of the kitchen hands sobbed. Prudence took one last look at the snowman, drew one last peaceful breath, and rolled up her sleeves again. The battle wasn't yet lost, but it was surely slipping away.
Suki, a mop, she declared. This isn't over yet.
Prudence Dorothea Bulstrode had never lost a battle in her life. Except perhaps the battle she was waging with the hedgehogs in her kitchen garden back home. In the end, she'd given up and started feeding them instead. And tonight was no exception. By the time 6 p.m. came around and the first villagers were trekking around the green to step into the warm, welcoming grounds of the Grange, the braised chuck stews were waiting, their muffin tops ready to be browned in the oven. The winter root crumbles were happily baking. The Scarborough woof was about to be baked with its potato rosties. And Prudence had prepped the figgy puddings to be dealt with as soon as the main courses were served. By now, the various kitchen assistants had taken flight, off to change into their waiting uniforms. And Prudence and Suki were alone, restoring the kitchen to some sense of order. Occasionally, Francesca the Fantastic popped her head around the door to satisfy herself that everything was going according to schedule. Prudence could sense her trepidation, but tried not to begrudge her it. This event was, perhaps, the biggest, most elaborate event to have taken place in Scrafton Busk's history, and Francesca, who ordinarily organised weddings, conferences, and one or two soft play parties for toddlers, had been drafted in from Harrogate, some miles to the south, to organise it.
Quite a change, Mrs. Bulstrode, from ensuring you've enough balloons to go with the party bags, or that you've enough cheesy puff crisps to go around. But we've got there in the end, haven't we?
The waiting staff were lined up outside the kitchen doors, ready to load up their serving trolleys. Prudence looked back at the window and the snowman, now only dimly visible in the gathering dark. Out there, the village was eerily empty, only a few last stragglers crossing the green and heading for the Grange. The great hall must have been full to bursting, 100 and more ravenous stomachs awaiting this meal.
I think we have,
Prudence answered Francesca.
Take it away.
Prudence herself accompanied the waiters out of the kitchen and into the Grange's grand reception area. There she stood with some modicum of pride as the waiters flocked into the great hall, marshalled by Francesca as they began to fill the tables. From here, Prudence could only catch glimpses of the crowded tables, but it was quite a sight to behold. How often in modern times did an entire village congregate like this? She wondered if it would ever have happened, even when the Grange was the local castle. Had the local lords ever been as generous as this? She was about to return to the kitchens, there was still so much to do, when the front doors of the Grange opened up, and an elegant lady with dark red hair and a face almost as red from the burning cold clattered through. Prudence recognised Meredith Goodman straight away. 30 years old, slender and lithe, and possessed of the kind of confidence only a public school education could cultivate, that being a confidence far beyond her actual merits. Meredith had been the first representative of forward reach that Prudence met. Tonight she was wearing a little black number, a faux fur stole, and for some reason Prudence could not quite understand, a great pair of Wellington boots, the kind a country girl might take out for a tramp in the fields, not the kind of footwear an elegant corporate go-getter wore to a banquet, even when she was out in the shires. Her eyes caught Prudence's as she hurried through. No doubt she had seen the way Prudence had lingered over the unusual footwear.
Oh, I went and snapped a heel out there on the ice. It's a wicked night, Mrs. Bulstrode. Francesca, your shoes, please.
My shoes? But evidently Francesca knew her place, for she was already taking them off. A pair of gleaming black court shoes. Meredith accepted them with only a minor level of distaste, then slipped them on her feet and rolled her eyes dramatically at Prudence.
No rest for the wicked, Mrs. Bulstrode, she said,
laughing with a slightly manic look in her eye. Then she peered through the flapping doors leading into the great hall.
Oh, Lord, I'm the last one here. I promised Dr. James I'd be first, but there's just so much to get through before the contracts get signed this week. That is, of course, if they ever get signed at all. We've your figgy puddings to rely on for that. I must get on, Mrs. Bulstrode. This is the night we've been waiting for.
She grasped Prudence's hand.
I can't thank you enough. With what you're doing for us here, I'm sure the village will begin to understand. Forward reach is for the people.
Then she scurried through the doors, taking her seat at the head table, where the other members of the Forward Reach Board, including her employer, the white-whiskered Dr. Michael James, a man who cared not for his receding hairline when he could replace it with the luscious waves falling over his shoulder, were gathered. Prudence heaved a sigh. The first phase of this epic job was complete. Now, it was on to the second. Francesca stood shoeless in the middle of the hall.
I suppose I'm wearing Wellis for the night then, am I?
She sighed.
Here,
said Prudence, and handed her a key card for the quarters she'd been given in the Grange rooms above.
I always come prepared, and we look just about the same size. It's the suitcase by the foot of the bed. See what takes your fancy.
Thank you, Mrs. Bulstrode.
And she faltered, uncertain if she should go on.
That woman has been the bane of this job for me. She's treating me like a secretary, having me open all the mail that gets sent for them here at the Grange. Well, there's a lot comes from the protesters, and they want that sifting out. Sending me on errands, running me like a dog who needs exhausting before bed. All I've ever wanted is to do a good job, for everything to go swimmingly, to perhaps just perhaps get a spot of recognition for it.
After Francesca was gone, Prudence hurried back to the kitchen, where as ever she found Suki gazing with some kind of awe into her iPhone. Prudence only hoped she wasn't looking at her own face in the camera. She let out another deep exhalation, loud enough to make Suki fumble her phone, then quickly hide it away.
It makes me glad I never worked in a professional kitchen, Suki. Can you imagine this every single night of your life? I've known enough chefs, my dear. Professional despots, everyone. She shook her head. And only the most vainglorious of them ever go and present themselves to their customers like we'll have to tonight. Prudence had always been doubtful about this particular part of the contract she'd signed, but after much discussion and various emails that Suki had sent back and forth, Prudence herself refusing to entertain anything as dastardly as an email address, she had agreed that, as the main course came to its conclusion, she would parade herself in front of the villagers.
"That's what they're paying you for, Grandma," Suki had said, with a roll of her eyes.
The girl had been reading all sorts of business books supplied to her by her dubious friend Numbers, and too often thought she had the whole world worked out.
"There are plenty of cooks they could have employed for this, but they asked for you. Your face, Grandma, that's what sets you apart. They'll want the whole village to see the lengths they've gone to."
"I expect I shall feel like I'm at Crufts," Prudence had replied. It wasn't that she was against a bit of publicity. Lord knows her whole career had been built out of it, and she'd never shied away from a magazine shoot or a place on a chat show sofa. In fact, she'd positively enjoyed them. Even in retirement, she liked a bit of the limelight here and there, a village fair, a local fete, a cooking demo where she might indulge in one of her old favourites, the raspberry roulade that had first made her name, or even the figgy pudding which she was quite certain had first led to this particular approach. But there was something about this job that had never sat right with her. She had been eager for the chance to return to the hills and dales of Yorkshire. How many times had she cooked in Harrogate and Richmond? How often did she dream of her father's old greengrocers and the early years of her childhood, pottering up and down the shambles in York or picnicking on the moors over Masham? All of that had appealed to her enormously. It was the manner of her engagement that rankled. The Forward Reach Energy Corporation had been generous with the package they offered, but something about their desperation to secure Prudence's services had set an alarm bell ringing. She supposed what she ought to have done was ask Suki and Numbers to go onto their internet and search them up. It was what Prudence's agent would have done back in the day, calling it due diligence and deducting 15% for the privilege. But instead, she'd agreed to the job and already made the Halloween trip to prepare the figgy puddings before she'd met their representative face to face and learned what they were about. Now, being paraded around like she was their pet and like she approved of everything they did was making her feel decidedly conflicted.
"Maybe I should fix your hair," said Suki. "I think you've got flour in it. Perhaps a clean apron?"
There was nothing Prudence approved of less than a cook with a clean apron. A stained apron was a loved apron. The very first thing Prudence did upon buying a new one was to christen it with hot chocolate and beetroot. "We have a little time, Suki, and there's prep for tomorrow yet." Whenever Suki's heart flagged, her shoulders dropped, and her body sagged like a comedian's impression of a tantruming teenager. Prudence watched it now with an anthropologist's detached interest. She'd been employing her granddaughter as her kitchen assistant for several months, and over that time she'd grown to be an indispensable aide. She'd changed so much from the reluctant and very often inebriated teenager with startling black makeup and a talent for idleness that she'd once been. But the one thing she'd very much remained was a teenager. "We didn't have teenagers in my day," Prudence had once said, completely ignoring the fact that she was not 100 years old. "We had young men and young women."
"But, Grandma, we've only just finished this."
"Yes, and now's the best time to get the jump on jobs for tomorrow. Don't forget, it's the local Member of Parliament and the Board of Forward Reach and the head of the parish council and her assistant, Prudence remembered. They were to take lunch in the Great Hall and discuss any remaining protestations at the presence of Forward Reach in the county. Yes, Prudence thought with a sigh. We've had more scrupulous and pleasant employers before. That delectable shooting party at Farley Manor in the Cotswolds, of course, yes, that had been a hoot. Even that lot had been more gentlemanly than Forward Reach. Come on, Suki, let's use our time wisely. We'll salvage what we can from this mess and make tomorrow a gentler kind of day. What do you think?
Suki didn't think much. She'd been rather looking forward to doing nothing more than scrolling through the messages on her iPhone, looking at some random pictures, and generally not using her mind for a little while. She'd been looking forward to getting off her feet, too, and perhaps sneaking one of the squidgy chocolate pears while she was at it. But now she picked herself up again and said, with more waspishness than she'd meant,
"Fine, Grandma. Where do we start?"
Soon, Prudence and Suki had restored the kitchen to some semblance of order, simmered a good number of beef bones into stock, and salvaged the last of the winter vegetables for tomorrow's minestrone. Prudence had just set Suki to making a poaching liqueur for the plums she would serve with lunch, when Francesca reappeared, wearing Prudence's glitziest emerald slippers, and declared the main course a triumph.
"There's 100 clean plates up there, Mrs. Bulstrode, with scarcely a smear on them. And now, well, now it's your time to shine."
Prudence had neither brushed the flour from her hair nor donned a clean apron. They would have to take her as she came. And secretly, that thought pleased her very much. The one token gesture she made toward tidying her appearance was to rinse her hands clean and wring them dry on a tea towel. Then she was following Francesca through the doors, calling back, "Suki, you too, I'll not do this on my own," and up into the Great Hall. The village had obviously been prepped for her arrival because there was a reverential hush beyond the doors, and the moment Prudence and Suki stepped through, the tables erupted with cheers and applause. It was unusual, Prudence reflected, for even the greatest meal to be met with a riot like this, and against her wishes, she broke into a smile. There were faces in the room that Prudence recognised. Father Tobias Stone, the priest from the neighbouring village of Gownley Pike, was sitting with a number of members of the parish council. As Prudence remembered, he was one of the more outspoken critics of Forward Reach's interest in the area, though, judging by the evidence of gravy in his whiskers, this didn't seem to have affected his enjoyment of tonight's proceedings. She was gazing out over the other faces. A good number of them had come to get their books signed, or just to take a selfie, which used to be called a photograph, with Prudence over the preceding days, when the ringing of a little handbell signalled that the night's speeches were about to begin. At the head table, Dr. James was rising to his feet, already being applauded by Meredith Goodman. The director of Forward Reach was about to have his say.
"Time for those figgy puddings to come out, I should think," Prudence whispered quietly.
Half the waiting staff were busy clearing tables, while Francesca marshalled the others at the doors of the Great Hall.
"Suki, you remember how to plate up? Are you sure you've got this?"
Suki rolled her eyes. "Figgy pudding on a plate, brandy sauce in teeny tiny little jugs on the side. I think I can handle it, Grandma."
As Prudence watched them leave, reminding herself that Suki didn't always need telling what to do and that the girl had shown more than a little initiative in their escapades of the past, Dr. Michael James began.
"My dear ladies, gentlemen, boys and girls of Scrafton Busk, it is my incomparable delight to have been able to bring you all together this evening. I have to say, first of course, that we have the unparalleled talents of Mrs. Prudence Bulstrode to thank for the delectable dinner we have all just consumed. And what I can only imagine is the finest figgy pudding ever to have graced a Yorkshireman's plate that I can see from the corner of my eye is about to be served. Prudence saw it too. The first of the trolleys were being wheeled into place. The smell reached her and lit up her senses. Yes, she was quite pleased with this one. The recipe was one she'd first taken from Mrs. Beaton's book of household management, and then adapted according to her own whims and tastes over the years. She'd perfected it the first Christmas she'd spent with her dearly departed Nicholas, and he had made the habit of requesting it every birthday from that point on as well, ignoring the fact that his birthday fell in the middle of June. "But the people I must thank most of all," Dr. James went on, "are the ones sitting in front of me. The good ladies and gentlemen, the young and the old, of this fine little village on the edge of the Yorkshire Dales. To my mind, one of the world's greatest natural wonders." There was more buttering up being done in this speech, thought Prudence, than if she were serving finger sandwiches to this entire room. "You see, I am not a blind man, nor am I deaf to the questions and concerns that have arisen since the Forward Reach Energy Corporation first applied for its license to conduct test drilling in these fine English hills. I am not immune to the criticism we have provoked. I am mindful of the concerns that have dogged this endeavour from the beginning. And, of course, there are many of you present tonight who have been forthright with those opinions in the local press, with a placard in your hands and, once or twice, some rather unsavoury letters arriving for me here at the Grange. Tut, tut." He grinned and slapped the back of his hand like a governess instructing a child. "No, of course we mustn't make light of the environmental concerns of our endeavour. Hydraulic fracturing has received much bad press in recent years, some of it warranted, but by no means all. But nor must we make light of the energy concerns of the modern world. Energy scarcity is to be one of the key battlefields of future geopolitics, and the sooner good old Blighty can stand on our own 2 feet again, the better." If this speech had been intended to win the hearts and minds of a village opposed to an energy corporation marching in and pillaging the area's natural beauty, all for an outdated form of power that itself did such irreparable damage to the planet, it was missing the mark by a country mile. It was Dr. James's good fortune, then, that the cavalry, in the shape of waiting staff, liberally spreading figgy pudding around the hall, had arrived. Prudence caught Suki's eye. Inexplicably, she had decided to join the staff and was sashaying between the tables, her arms precariously piled high with pudding. "But we can only hope," Dr. James went on, though none of the room now seemed to be listening, "that in bringing the delectable Mrs. Bulstrode to you this evening, and by way of this fine meal we're all sharing, you can see that when your proud Member of Parliament receives news from Westminster that our work in these hills can begin in earnest, we will always have the constituents of this humble village as our primary concern. So, now to our puddings and..." Dr. James's words petered out. Prudence supposed he was about to raise his glass and make a toast to the hall, but the villagers had already set about their puddings with gusto. This was exactly what Prudence loved to see. Brandy sauce was being spilled, and mouths were growing sticky with dates, figs, and a mountain's worth of muscovado sugar. Somewhere, a group of families had started singing, "We all want some figgy pudding. We all want some figgy pudding. We all want some figgy pudding. So bring it right here." The song's tunelessness brought tears to Prudence's eyes. She might not have approved of being used to advance a big corporation's demands over the concerns of this village, but there was enough joy in the room to negate every ill feeling. Besides, she felt quite certain the village was not here to be won over. They were here for that wonderful feeling you got when your belly was full to bursting and you hadn't done 1 ounce of the cooking. Dr. James and Meredith Goodman were evidently debating the very same thing. In the corner of her eye, Prudence could see their hand gestures grow more and more animated, and she was quite certain she heard Meredith saying,
"It doesn't matter what they think, sir. We'll have every signature we need after we meet Mrs. Thrush tomorrow."
She was also quite certain they were trying to involve her in the conversation, no doubt to discuss tomorrow's lunch service. So it was a stroke of the most amazing good fortune that, at that moment, a rapturous cry went up at a table in the heart of the room.
"I've got it!"
a young boy of perhaps 9 or 10 years was exclaiming, waving his fist in the air triumphantly, while at the same time nursing his jaw.
"I've got it! I'm the winner! The winner! I tell you, the winner!"
The hall was so vast that at first only the neighbouring tables turned to him, but soon the consternation was drawing every eye in the hall. Then Dr. James was back on his feet. "I see we have a surprise. What's this, Mrs. Bulstrode? Do I detect something a little bit showbiz, perhaps?"
"I'm not quite sure,"
Prudence had begun to say, but the commotion at the table was continuing, and she saw now that Suki was on the scene. Moments later, she was waving her grandmother over, and Prudence, never one to ignore a curiosity, began picking her way there. The table had not been full for the dinner service. By the placemats and their decorations, Prudence saw that the man with the dark hair, day-old stubble and cherubic cheeks, was David Chandler, and that the woman on his left, perhaps 38 years old, blonde and beautiful but with weary eyes, no doubt due to the baby she was cradling, was Rachel, his wife. A seat opposite them, marked Terry Chandler, had remained empty for the dinner. One villager, perhaps, who didn't like the hypocrisy of dining courtesy of the corporation, and the rest were occupied by a family named Booth. It was the son of this family who, while nursing his jaw, was holding his fist aloft. Now that Prudence got near, she could see that he was holding a fat coin between his fingers, while his mother prized apart his jaws to inspect the damage done to his tooth.
"Somebody could have told us there was a coin in the pudding," the boy's mother was crowing. "There's a filling come straight out, once he took a chump on that. Don't you know how rare a free dentist appointment is around here? You've more chance finding a coin in a pudding."
"It's mine!"
the boy started chanting, victorious despite his mother's fingers ferreting around his mouth.
"Pirate gold!"
"Nice surprise, Grandma," Suki grinned. "But what is it? It looks like you dug it up out of the garden." So it did. From what Prudence could fleetingly see as the boy waved his fist back and forth, it was no ordinary pound coin. It was bigger, for a start, and the dents in its surface were certainly not the work of that poor boy's jaws. It looked, Prudence thought, almost like a Christmas stocking chocolate coin, one that had been squished out of shape, then left to harden on the mantel. On the other side of the table, David and Rachel Chandler were sharing a look of such alarm that it was almost as if it was their child who wouldn't stop squawking. But their surprise was nothing compared to Prudence's own.
"Well, that coin isn't mine," Prudence began.
"Of course it's not," the boy slobbered. "It's mine! All mine!"
"Here," began David Chandler. "Let me see."
"No,"
the boy declared, and closed his fist tight around the coin.
"That's the rules of treasure, finders keepers."
Suki had sidled to Prudence's side.
"It really isn't yours, Grandma."
"No," said Prudence,
her brow furrowing in both bewilderment and concern.
"And I don't like the thought of somebody tampering with my pudding, Suki, whether it's for a fun Christmas surprise or not."
She looked over her shoulder. At the front of the hall, Dr. Michael James and Meredith Goodman were leading another toast. This one, though scarcely half the room was listening, to the young man whose discovery had become the thrill of the evening.
"Mark my words, ladies and gentlemen," Dr. James was pronouncing. "There'll be many more riches for little Scrafton Busk than that when our contract is signed and our work can begin. You won't have to go digging around in a figgy pudding for your gold. Not then. Oh, no. This project is going to be for the betterment of you all. Three cheers!"
They were, thought Prudence later that night, the least convincing three cheers of them all. Two hip replacements and hardly half a hooray. But that was not the thing that irked her as she turned the lights out in her room in the Grange and thought about tomorrow's luncheon. It was one thing, she thought, to be paraded around as if she herself was a mascot for whatever skullduggery Forward Reach were planning up here. But it was quite another for somebody to have brought her figgy pudding into it. No, she thought with a sigh, that just wouldn't do at all. That figgy pudding was sacred. Chapter 2. Prudence was still smarting the next morning when, bright and early, she descended to the kitchens, leaving Suki exactly where she wanted to be, tucked up in bed, bathing in the glow of her iPhone screen. Now, first having stewed some tea and toasted some crumpets, she stood in the window to gaze out over the green. It was just as perfect as ever. Fresh snow had fallen while Prudence slept, and the village was coated in a virginal white, crisscrossed only by the tracks of early morning dog walkers and whatever foxes roam the village by night. A sight like this could restore the balance after that moment last night. Now that her mind returned to it, she started smarting again that somebody had come down here to these kitchens and interfered with her figgy puddings. So she refocused her attention on the fragrant steam coming from her tea, white rose and hibiscus, and the idyllic view out of the kitchen window. The world was a wonder of white, but for the first time, Prudence noticed something different in Scrafton Busk. The green was white as fondant, but a single shock of red punctured its furthest side. Prudence had been standing here every morning for the past several days, luxuriating in the wintry splendour of it all. But how had it been that, until now, she'd never spotted a blood-red pillar box standing on the other side of the expanse? It was crowned in snow, but its scarlet was plain to see. Indeed, it made the whole thing look like a picture postcard more than ever. There was the green, just the same as it had always been, the great oak tree, the benches, the snowman that the village children had made. But for some reason, today a red postbox had been added to the picture. One of the villagers was ambling towards it and depositing their Christmas cards right now. Prudence was still furrowing her eyes at this strange new addition to the scene when Suki staggered through, bleary-eyed and yawning like only a teenager can be, and started ferreting around for the cafetiere. Prudence had nothing against a strong coffee on a morning. It was certainly better than the energy drinks and diet colas Suki used to neck as soon as she woke up, but the girl had become reliant on it in the last couple of months.
"One vice for another, Suki dear," she said, and bustled to make the coffee for her.
"Suki, do me a favour, would you? Go and stand there in the kitchen window by the sink."
"Oh, Grandma," Suki exclaimed with horror. "I've only just woken up. Can't the washing up wait?"
Actually, thought Prudence, the washing up could never wait.
There was a singular joy in washing up that most other cooks on the television circuit didn't understand. They all had their kitchen hands and production assistants doing the dirty work, but Prudence had always liked to get her fingers sudsy herself. Washing up occupied just enough of the brain to let the other part get carried away in some flight of the imagination. Washing up was where she'd come up with her idea for poppy seed strudel. But this morning, washing up was the furthest thing from Prudence's mind. "The sink's empty, my dear. I don't leave kitchens festering overnight. Indulge me, Suki, please." So Suki went to stand in the window. "What am I looking at, Grandma?" "Do you see anything different this morning?" Suki stared dumbly, then shrugged. "Come on, Suki. You're more observant than that. What have I been teaching you?"
An awful lot of things, actually, thought Prudence. Basic knife skills and kitchen hygiene, all manner of prep work, filleting and deboning, sauce making and stock. But the most important lesson Prudence had tried to impart was that a cook's greatest skill was her mind.
A good cook doesn't just follow a recipe. She follows her instincts. She can taste a recipe and know exactly what it needs. Does it have too little of this? Has it had a dash too much of that? She sees and senses everything around her, Suki. So, please, look again.
At least Suki had a coffee in her hand now. She luxuriated in its scent, scalded her tongue, and then looked again.
"I don't know, Grandma. That snowman's nose is on back to front, if that's what you're asking."
"What?"
Prudence hurried back to the window.
"No, not that, Suki dear. I expect it dropped off or some hungry bird was worrying at it. No, Suki, I'm talking about
And she pointed.
"A postbox, Grandma. I would have thought you'd know what a postbox is, seeing as you've never managed to grasp the idea of an email address."
Suki seemed to mean this as some jocular slight, but to Prudence it was actually a badge of honour.
"I know what it is, Suki, but..."
And here, Prudence's train of thought completely derailed. How could a postbox just materialise overnight? Perhaps it had been covered by so much snow that she'd simply not seen it. She was still contemplating that particular conundrum when Francesca appeared in the kitchen door. She was carrying a plastic coffee cup from a place called Starsky's, which just went to show that anything that started in London, sandwich chains, coffee franchises, burger joints where your meal was put together with less finesse than in the lion enclosure at London Zoo, eventually made its way out into the parishes.
"Up bright and early, I see, Mrs. Bulstrode. Well, that's wonderful. A bit of news. I'm told there's an extra two for lunch. That makes it Mrs. Thrush, her husband, Dr. James and Ms. Goodman from Forward Reach. Mr. Arkwright, he's coming down from the County Council at North Allerton. And now two journalists from the Northern Echo. So it's all the stars today. I'm sure you can rustle up a couple of extra plates, can you?"
Prudence nodded.
"We'll be ready in good time, Francesca."
"Well, that's the other thing," said Francesca. "The lads at the Echo got wind that the protesters were getting together to stage something over lunch, so there's been a message go round. You know how they get. It's so easy to rally the troops nowadays. WhatsApp, Facebook, Messenger, Insta, whatever."
As she was speaking, Prudence gave Suki a dramatic roll of the eyes.
"So we've decided to head them off, stage the lunch an hour or two early. We were thinking 11 a.m. Everyone can get here just in time."
11 a.m.? said Prudence. "A little early for lunch, isn't it?"
"Well, exactly. Just make it a brunch kind of thing. You can do that, can't you?"
Prudence tried not to let her mind whirl back to all of yesterday's prep, the stock and the soup base and the pastry she had sitting in the frigidaire, waiting to be blind baked for the tartlets. Not for the first time, she wondered why she'd ever begun this second career, whisking her camper van up and down the country for private events.
Cooking was one thing, and she would never lose her passion for it. Being spun around and made to dance for events organisers was quite another. And yet she'd had to grin and bear much worse things in the past. Just about every television set in her career had featured some busybody pottering around, switching up plans without any care or attention to anyone else. More than one raspberry roulade had been ruined that way. "Suki," she said when Francesca had left, "looks like we'll have to think again." She looked up at the wall, and the clock is ticking. 11 a.m. came around far too quickly for Prudence's liking, but by the time it was approaching, she was certain they'd rustled up a brunch to be proud of. The tartlets had become miniature quiches. There had been some plump heritage sausages in the larder, and Suki had become a dab hand at poaching eggs. The minestrone had been abandoned, but Prudence had been able to use some of the leftover vegetables from yesterday in the breakfast rostis she'd made. The fresh chimichurri, not exactly an authentic Argentinian recipe, but a version which would suit these sausages well, was her own gesture towards modernity. At least it brought some colour to the plates, along with the vibrant red of the roast tomatoes. "They'll be wanting a dessert too, of course," Prudence had observed, but she didn't intend to make any changes to her lunchtime menu on this front. Poached plums and brandy snaps went with just about anything. As the clock reached 11 a.m, the waiting staff appeared, Francesca flapping alongside them. "No protesters yet," she chirped, and Prudence nodded. She was standing at the window, eyes drawn to that curious pillar box again, and there was no sign of any protest outside the Grange. The green was filled with children playing snowballs and sledging, though the incline was so gentle there was very little sport in it. But of an angry mob with placards in hand, there was not a whisper.
"This smells delicious, Mrs. Bulstrode, just delicious, and you'll present dessert yourself, will you?"
Prudence startled, her eyes opening in astonishment.
"Well, forward reach, have asked for it, Mrs. Bulstrode. This is such an important meeting for them. They want the whole county on side. If they're to get this contract signed by the end of the week, Mrs. Thrush seems to be wavering. She's under some pressure from Westminster, I understand. But she'll come down on their side if Mr. Arkwright and the others can be convinced. Then, if there's no more governmental objections..."
She smiled, making pleading eyes at Prudence. "Just pop up with the plums and say hello, won't you?
Thank you, Mrs. Bulstrode. Thank you so much."
Francesca and the waiting staff had departed long before Prudence could spirit up another objection, but the look on Suki's face seemed to sum it all up.
"Go on, Grandma," she laughed. "If you're very good, they might give you a lollipop."
And Suki's laughter might have rung on and on right then, if only, in exactly the same moment, there hadn't come from outside the most ear-rending scream Prudence had ever heard. A girl's scream, a child's scream, a scream born from terror unimaginable, rising into the skies above Scrafton Busk, bringing in its wake silence to the village green. Suki was the first to the window, but Prudence wasn't far behind. The scream hadn't just brought silence to the green, where moments ago the air had been full of whoops and cheers, gales of laughter, the joie de vivre of a crisp winter day. It had brought stillness as well. Out there, every soul was frozen solid, as if this truly was a picture postcard. Except, in picture postcards, mouths weren't ordinarily open in terror. In picture postcards, a little girl wasn't ordinarily sobbing in the arms of her traumatised father. In picture postcards, there wasn't ordinarily a dead man's arm hanging out of the body of a snowman, while a dozen horrified families looked on. Prudence could not run as quickly as Suki, but together they tumbled out of the front doors of the Grange, hurrying past the place where their camper van sat.
its bright colours of peach and cyan, now capped in thick snow, until they reached the edge of the green. Only moments had passed, but the petrification of the village green seemed to have worn off. Families were covering their children's eyes. Children were being marshalled away. Multiple telephones were out and being waved in the air as people sought reception strong enough to put through an emergency call.
"Yes, police!" somebody was shouting. "Police and fast!"
And "Ambulance! Bring an ambulance!" somebody else was screaming. Though now that Prudence had got close, she could quite clearly see that no ambulance was needed. For the arm that hung out of the snowman was frozen solid. Its fingertips, rimed with dirt, were a vivid blue. Whoever the body belonged to, it had been dead for some time, sitting here, waiting to be discovered. The cruelest of antidotes to a chocolate box winter day. And here was Prudence Bulstrode and her kitchen hand Suki, looking straight into the face of another grisly murder. Prudence did not know what to make of Detective Tom Beck as she watched him busying around the edges of the green, directing the forensics officers and other constables who had quickly streamed into Scrafton Busk. She had known many men who didn't care for their appearance. As a matter of fact, she'd fallen in love with one. Nicholas was a man who eschewed Savile Row for the pleasures of a good charity shop whenever his wife wasn't dragging him to some celebrity shindig, and had often observed that the most talented cerebral men frequently overlooked the mustard stain on their lapels. Or that the laces in their shoes were just frayed collections of knots. A mathematician could probably have plotted it on a graph, intellect against slovenliness, and produced a pretty decent result. The problem was that you never quite knew when the state of a man's hair, and Detective Beck's was as tangled and tousled as a hedgerow, with one or two leaves embedded in it for good measure, was the byproduct of genius.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.